Do present.
So today we have with us Soumya Mani Tripathi. She's a PhD scholar at the School of Arts and Aesthetics, JNU, New Delhi. And she is currently assistant professor at MET School of Film.
I left MET. Okay.
So you left within this week only?
No. I left in March, and these are the students that I've brought from there. I'm currently freelancing with UNESCO and some other organizations on some
research. Okay, so like this is not there in the short bio sent to me, isn't it?
Arey yaar, wo purana hai. Sorry.
Okay, so she has worked at MET University, and she is researching on trauma, memory, and cultures of resistance in Kashmir as part of her PhD thesis. She's a theater practitioner and an aspiring filmmaker. She'll be today delivering a lecture, a completely different kind of a lecture, where she'll be dealing with the concept of sexuality from the perspective of Nayikas, okay, and maybe theater or whatever she wants to do. So on behalf of myself and my students, I welcome her, and over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Muzaffar. Okay, so...
So everybody can see this? The screen?
Can you see the presentation screen? Yeah.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's begin. So since we have a very diverse kind of audience today, I don't know the level of each one of you. So I thought I'll take you through some basics that I wanted to clarify at the beginning of the lecture. I'm not a philosophy student. I am not a gender studies student as well, but I have used a lot of gender studies work and philosophy in my research, in my art practice as well. So we are going to be looking at Indian art through the perspective of sexuality. And when you study philosophy students, especially you, when you study different perspectives on sexuality after this, you'll be able to relate this. This can serve as a lot of case study for your understanding of sexuality, of your understanding of sociology, how sexuality manifests in politics, in time, in societies, in civilizations, in gender roles, in any time, in any political context. Okay. So yeah, next slide, please. Yeah. So I hope all of you are on the same page on what is the basic difference between sex and gender. So in between, if some of you feel like talking, because I am a very interactive person, I don't do lectures looking at phone at myself. So I would really appreciate if I can get some answers and you can come in and, you know, answer this.
That's my way as well. They'll be doing that.
Okay. So... ek to na Muzaffar, I can't see myself, so I'm just like main screen pe dekh rahi hu aur main bol rahi hu. So if I am out of frame, if you can only see my nose or something like that, please let me know. Okay, yeah. So sex is basically biological. It is a gender assigned male or female at birth, whereas gender is a social construct. It is performative. Gender is formative. Gender is something, how do you identify yourself as, okay? Sex can, people who are assigned sex, suppose male at birth or female at birth, can suffer from gender dysphoria. Now, gender dysphoria is a condition where one feels at variance with one's birth sex. So, for example, you're born in a male body, but you feel feminine, you feel like a woman inside, okay? Whereas in gender terms, you discover sexuality. You have already discovered your gender. Now you discover your sexuality. So that you're homosexual, you're heterosexual, you're bisexual, you're queer, you're trans. Okay. So there are three categories in sex: male, female, hermaphrodite, which is common classification for all living beings. It is in plant kingdom, it is in animal kingdom, and by definition, human beings being mammals, it classifies as that. Whereas in gender is more about, and this is only in human, gender is a very human perspective. It's only unique to human civilization, where you experience gender and sexuality as an expression of desire, love, sexual pleasure, fetish, identity, way of seeing the world and enacting and performing in it. Okay. So gender categories are cisgender, which means you are born male at birth and you feel male. Okay. So if your gender alignment, if your sex alignment is in line with your gender alignment, it is called as cis. If you're born with female organs and you feel feminine, if you're born with male organs and you feel masculine or you feel as a man, then if there is no dysphoria, then it is cisgender. If you are homosexual, that means you are attracted to the same sex. Heterosexual, attracted to the opposite sex. Transgender and transsexual mein difference ye hai ki transgender basically means you're born in a different body but you belong to a different gender. When do you become transsexual? When you undergo GRS surgery or you change, manipulate organs and bodies in your in your body. So GRS is gender reassignment surgery, which a lot of people go through to feel at sync with their gender identity. Okay, so if a man is born and he feels that he's a woman inside, he's feminine inside, they would go under GRS, hormonal therapy, and feel at sync with the gender that they identify with. Okay, I think that this is pretty basic with everything, the difference between sex and gender. So whenever I'm talking about gender identity, know that it means the social construct, the performance, the idea of that particular sex, how it navigates in a particular body in a particular time. Whereas when I'm talking about sex, it means the biology of it. Okay. Okay. Next. Next slide. Oh, yeah. Thank you. Now, what do we get out of studying art and sexuality? Okay. Since you know that, how do we trace as a human being and to be called as a civilization, it is very important to have memory, to have sense of self, to have a sense of history. And the greatest tools and sources that we have so far used in tracing history has been logic, scientific, things like archaeology, architecture, language, culture, paintings, artifacts. And a large part of this belongs to the realm of the art, okay? Belongs to the realm of interpretation and representation, okay? So art, all of them, visual, performance, religious art, and cinematic. In fact, cinema is one of the only art forms whose history we can trace by date, that this is the exact date that this art form was born. Otherwise, all other art forms predate any historical record. We don't have record. It predates basically to the condition as long as humans existed. When we discover new sources, new sites, we say that, okay, this is the evidence. But it basically exists as long as humans have existed. Okay, all art aligns with the existence of human beings and their bodies. So body becomes the center of representation, the center of expressing desire, the center of creating ideals of beauty, what is considered beautiful, what is considered grotesque in a certain civilization. And also, the body then is a tool of political assertion. It is a sociological composition. And the body also engages in philosophical dimensions of how a society is organized. So one of the, you must have read Plato's text and his interpretation of polis, of art, of mimesis, and all of that. And at the center of it is art. It is constantly talking about, experience of human beings in a society. Okay. And why we are studying it today, why as philosophers, as filmmakers, as people who have nothing to do with painting, okay, with nothing to do with visual arts, why are we studying this today? Because now more and more these sources have become the foundation to debate between faith and reason. Where you have people saying that Ganesha was the first plastic surgery versus any, when myth becomes history. History and myth are now interchangeable. In fact, we are facing a double damage because historians are fighting amongst themselves so much that we have so many interpretations of history that ultimately myth is winning over. Because myth is homogenous. It is saying that this is the one true thing that will transcend everything and we don't need logic. So in today's society, we are faced with this constant battle of faith and reason. And art and sexuality is central to that debate. So in order to make sense of society that we are living in today and to reclaim that history, we need to definitely look at this source. Okay. This is not exactly the chronological order that I would go on, but I have at least taken a chronological linear historical path so that you get an idea visually as well, how we evolved visually from 10th, from 1st century BC to contemporary time. But also it touches upon a lot of dimensions of sexuality that I want to talk about. Okay. Yeah. Next. Okay, so one of the first cultures, first representations of a female body, of sexual bodies, as we say, is in the Mesolithic area, where we get like thousands of cultures of prehistoric Venus. This is the body of that is worshipped, okay, as fertility goddess named. So she has different names, okay. In India, in Turkey, in Romania, in Iran, in different parts of the world, the likes of this culture has been found. And it is an anthropomorphic image. So basically something human, but we don't know its gender because the face is not visible. So face is not important at all. Maybe it's saying that. And this huge voluptuous figure with, with almost pregnant-like women with huge breasts and thighs and abundance of body fat is the ideal beauty that is worshipped at this time, that is considered as the mother goddess or as the fertility goddess, as the abundance in society, basically. And you can clearly see that here it is far, far away from any kind of gaze, from any kind of catering to gaze. That it's not catering to a male gaze, it's not looking at men, it's not titillating, it's not asking you to come, it's not asking you to look at it and have pleasure. It's not even fearful, it's not asking you to worship it and be fearful of its sexuality. It just is female body in all its glory, okay, fertility in all its glory. Without apology, without any sense of gratification to the audience. It's just there as it is. Now, it is in this same age, later this age, that we find the other painting that you can see, which is called as The Thinker of Sarvanoda. Now, this is one of the first times that gender is, or any body, for example, is shown not just as a goddess or as a figure up the pedestal, as a worshipper, but shown as a thinking being. Okay, this has inspired, if you might have seen, there's a very famous sculpture by Rodin, the famous bronze sculptor, a thinking man. It's very, there's a man who's sitting like this and thinking. It's a very famous sculpture, very replicated in popular art. But this is what has inspired Rodin basically to do that. And this is one of the first times that we see neither sexual representation of two bodies, neither very worshipping image of these two bodies, okay? So neither in war, okay? All of these depictions, hatake, ye pehli baar hai that we are seeing something of a hint of a human, a hint of a secular human man, an artist, not as a ritual, art object, not as a ritual object, art object, not as a worship object or as a monument for the king, but art object just to celebrate a psychological mood, just to represent human beings sitting with each other. Okay, man and a woman by the body figure, you can tell, although it's not very gender specific, there's not many traits in the body that you can say one belongs to this specific gender or not. It's very gender ambiguous. But still, this is one of the first moments that we get representation of bodies like this. Okay, aage bade. Yes. So let's come to the Indian art. Now, Indian art is one of the earliest expressions. Achha, what is this? Everybody, please give me a shout out. You guys are in Pune. You know what is this? Where is this?
Pune.
Anyone? Can anyone answer me? Where is this?
Does anyone know?
No, ma'am.
No, sir. No, ma'am.
Something, have you seen something like this ever in very popular early Indian art likha hota hai jahan pe?
Right now they are
ma'am, the central picture looks very familiar, but I'm unable to place it.
Okay.
Right, so now they are just doing some renovation work at Pune Airport. So I think that this middle picture or the one on the left, something mm-hmm. around it, something related to, is being put up there, but I'm not sure.
Okay. So these are all murals from Ajanta Cave.
Okay.
In Aurangabad. Yeah. So as you know, Ajanta Caves have hosted one of the earliest Indian art in history. And these are representations of women from that cave, where we see natural pigment, the paintings that have survived for the longest time, basically. So let's go one by one. The painting to your right, the first painting with three women, can be, this is an entire painting in itself. Okay, it's a wall mural. I hope you know what a mural is. A mural is a painting done on the wall, on an architectural surface, okay, inside the temple, on the roof of the church, on windows, on caves. Okay, so mural is not done on paper or wood or any such substance. Mural is done on walls. So it's done on architectural pieces, basically. So this is a mural from Ajanta Cave, which all of them are based on Jatak stories. Jatak stories are mythic stories based on lives of Buddha. It's like Panchatantra ki kahaniya, kind of, where several things happen and people learn their lessons from Buddha and from Siddhartha's life. The first one that we were talking about, if you can see closely and zoom in a little bit, if you can. This woman is, the other woman is clearly touching her breast. So this is like an undeniable source of homosexuality, lesbianism in the first art form that India has stored. Okay. So this is one of the most important iconic murals that stand out as a homosexual depiction in art, which can't be denied. Okay. Even in the stories, you can't deny it. So both of, and it's very natural. It's not very vulgar, or it's not. And these are all named as princesses. They have been cataloged as princess of here, princess of there. Okay, some queen or some story. Miss, nobody is a lowly life. So even the caste angle, because caste is a tool that is used a lot. Caste and tribal identity is used as a device to other, is used as something ki acha is caste ya isko belong karta hai, to definitely it will be uncivilized to other the civilized. Okay, so wo bhi nahi kar sakte kyunki ab to princess likha hai. Now you, on the second most painting, you see something called as black apsara. Okay, this all of these paintings are highly important and highly controversial and an eyesore for Hindu Rashtra. Because how can anyone with a black skin be called apsara, according to the most Brahminized, Sanskritized, you know, upper class, upper caste Hindu regime that we are living amongst today? How can this woman be called as apsara? Okay, how can a black person be an apsara? And that too, this depiction is in Maharashtra. So clearly we have influence from, you know, we have subversion of North Indian idea of female beauty constantly. The third depiction is also Princess Shivagami, something her name is. And she's basically addressing to some other woman to bring her something to drink. Okay, she's just woken up. This is not your typical image. This is not your image of a goddess. This is not your image of a Kali. This is just a lazy woman sleeping naked. Okay, this is just a princess living her lavish life, not even looking at you. She's not catering to your gaze. She's not interested in looking at you. She's not offering her body for pleasure. She just is. And this that we are seeing, 1, 2, 3, now finally we have arrived in the postmodern era where we actually see in women's bodies, in work of arts, in cinema, in poetry, in theater, where they do not cater to the male gaze, where they do not address the male audience, where they are living their lives as it is. Okay. Where when they're showering, they're not catering to male gaze, they're just cleaning their bodies. So sexuality for just as it is, as a part of living, as a part of expression. Bodies just for they are, okay? Devoid of any gaze, devoid of any context, of any condition of shame, of any propaganda, okay? These are bodies just as it. Different variations of female sexuality. In different color, in different body, in different race, in different sexual orientation. Okay, and it takes us about 1,000 years to arrive here. I don't know if we are at the same place again or not, because this seems more regressive. Okay, next. Yes. So after this, this is a very controversial point that I'm going to make, which is that Buddhism brought in religious iconification with it, brought in codes of gender with it, that were not fully, that accepted the already existing tribal regime, that existed expressions of sexuality of prehistoric civilization. What is this noise? Muzaffar, is somebody's audio on? I can hear this constant noise.
No, it's just that people get thrown out from the system and they have to be constantly added in.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Is it fine now? I have added this person.
Yeah. Now, yeah. Thank you. Please give me a shout out if you are getting anything. Am I making sense? Are you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, yeah. Ma'am, I would just like to appreciate the first picture that you showed us, because there are multiple times when when we are talking about the way that men and women have been portrayed in sculptures, in murals, in paintings, it is always this gendered understanding that we see in there. And the first picture that you showed really made a difference, that okay, there was somebody who was thinking along these lines, wherein a woman could just be a woman, that's it, nothing else. She could be a subject in herself, not an object of
desire.
Glaze. Yeah.
Oh, desire is good, gaze is bad, yeah. Agree. Okay, so what happened was, religion, the very idea of organized religion, thrives on control of women's sexuality. Okay, all organized religions that have survived till today thrive on the idea of control of human sexuality, female sexuality, female bodies, and that they reinforce with heterosexuality, that they reinforce with celebrating the motherhood, constantly dividing women into good and bad categories, that this is the good women of patriarchy, this is the bad women of patriarchy, and constantly regulating pleasure. So sex is not for pleasure. Sex is only to reproduce. So by the time Buddhism came in and it took over all the existing tribal philosophies, aniconic philosophies, pagan rituals, okay, everything that worshipped nature, female body in nature, that celebrated the previous, you know, the voluptuous woman, okay? So they were still in this civilization, so they couldn't completely go out of it. So in order to appropriate it, in order to get more followers, because that is the agenda of all religions, okay? All religions want to get more followers. That is like the basic thing. No religion on earth will ever tell you, organized religion. Organized religion mein teen parts hote hain, which makes them identifiable. which is the book. They all have a book that they refer to, a sacred book, a place of worship, a grand place of worship. So, for example, Mecca or pilgrimage or, you know, Chardham or whatever you call it, or this Bethlehem. Okay. And what is the third? The third is, yes, the priest figure. So one holy priest figure that they follow. Okay, the Pope or whatever, Mathadish, okay? One grand priest figure that they follow. This is common to all religions. They're highly patriarchal and misogynist in nature. Why? Because religion thrives through control of women's sexuality. All organized religions do that. And that is why there's nothing in practice that should defy homosexuality or homoromanticism, for example, right? It's very natural. It shouldn't threaten religion. But why does it threaten religion? Why are mostly all religions against homosexuality? It's because homosexuality does not end up in producing more offspring for that religion. It does not produce more followers of that religion. So, and also because then female sexuality, we need monogamy, we need to control women's body so that the clan can be protected. Everything is about land. The man inherits the land, so the children need to know that these are his children and that land will be passed on to them. And therefore, instead of regulating the man, they regulate the female body, which could possibly produce a lot of children for a lot of men. So she, her body, her womb is taken control of. Okay. So by the time Buddhism arrived, the philosophy of Buddhism arrived, yes, there is a lot of enlightenment. There is a lot of acceptance. There's a lot of appropriation as well. Okay. Appropriation of goddesses, appropriation of existing goddesses, and they make a myth. So I'll give you an example. There's a Buddhist goddess called Hariti, and in any religion, in any time, if you're a man with a child, there's one thing you will absolutely not negotiate in, which is the health of your child. Okay, if your wife is in labor, if she is dying, if your child is in trouble, he is dying, then no matter what kind of an atheist you are, okay, even in prehistoric times, if somebody tells you, go worship this one and he will get cured, you will do that. There's no logic, no rationality to that. Children defy that. Okay, so this cult of Hariti, of this female goddesses who used to protect women in childbirth, who used to protect women in and children in diseases in the early childhood period, were huge followers, attracted huge, huge followers. And when Buddhism came in, they of course wanted those followers, but they could not just, you know, yes, there is full frontal war and there is battle and there is kingdom taken over and religion is sanctioned through kings. But there is also softer powers, okay, through education, through culture that is done. So what they did was they appropriated this story. They said that Hariti, have you all seen Tumbar?
No.
The film Tumbar?
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
I was actually going to ask you about, like, when this picture of the birthing mother came up. Because in Tumbar, yeah, they have spoken about this goddess.
So this and her is the womb. Same goddess. That Hariti, the goddess that they have chosen, Hastar, jinka beta hai, that's Hariti. Okay, so how Buddhism portrayed this story is that this woman loved his first child and his first child was very notorious. So Buddha captured him in his bowl, he hid him, and so she realized that she is a mother after all, she loves him after all. So she asked Buddha to release him and said that, okay, I won't be a demon anymore, I won't eat children anymore. I will protect children if you give me my son back. Okay, so Buddha laid all of these conditions, 4 or 5 conditions that he can't do this, he's very greedy, he can only survive on this, the story that uses in Tumbar. But I will release him and from now on you will protect. So they just added Buddha, you know, very clinically, very surgically to the story. And so what happened was the site remained the same, the temple remained the same, the sculpture remained the same, but that became a Buddhist site instead of a pagan tribal site, okay? And that goddess became Hariti. And later on, when Hinduism came, they did the exact same thing. And you know what that goddess is called as? She's called as Sitla Mata today. So in every, there are different variations, different names, But in every town, every cult, every culture of this land, you will find one or the other female deity protecting motherhood and protecting the child. Everywhere you'll find. Because this is something non-negotiable. This is something everybody gives in. So after coming of Buddhism, if you go to Lumbini at the Maya Devi temple, at the site where Buddha was born, you will enter and you will find something like the second sculpture. Where Maya Devi, this is the episode of the, this episode is called The Birth of Buddha. The woman who is holding the tree. So Buddha was very keen to come in early on earth. And so she was traveling from her parents' house to her husband's house, Maya Devi. But in between, she went into labor. And in middle of this jungle, she was holding a tree and she gave birth to Buddha. This posture is called as Shalabhanjika, the one holding the branches of the trees. So it's also depicted as something that, you know, the whole cosmic energy, the whole nature came in and helped her, you know, helped bring Buddha into the world. So to portray this episode as a divine episode of birth, it is portrayed this way. And if you go in Maya Devi temple, this is exactly the sculpture that you'll find in there. Okay, a woman holding both the trees and birthing Buddha. So the cult of the birthing mother, because of course sexuality humse handle nahi hoti, so sexuality ka ek hi purpose hai, birthing mother. Yahan se problem shuru ho gayi. Anything and everything, even till today, if we discover any sculpture of any woman, the first thing we do by, you know, in order to caption it is add the word goddess to it or mother to it. Okay. There will hardly be any sculpture that comes out and we can recognize it ki nahi, ye nahi hai. It is neither a woman, it is neither a yogini, it is neither an apsara. It is just a woman. It will never happen. Ever. So this anxiety with handling female pleasure, with handling female body and human sexuality is very evident in how we caption, how we title our works today, how we study art history today. Okay. So you see the first and the second prehistorical times mein representation ki female body ka matlab kya hai? Sirf birthing mother. Okay. Women in labor were worshipped, women in going to birth were worshipped. Okay, next. I need to keep track of time here. Yeah. Whereas, if you go from early to late Buddha, you also see, so in the first culture, this is from Mathura, the left one. Lefty hai na, mera to left hai, haan. Yeah, the left one, where you see a little bulge between the thighs of Buddha. Okay, so this is the time that Buddha has been accepted into a cult figure. He has been celebrated. He has been established as somebody semi-divine or somebody very great, but he's still considered human. In art, he's still represented as somebody human. So
neutral, you see, neutral to the sexes.
Yeah, exactly. So there's no grand gesture of, you know, taking off some body parts or enlarging some body parts or hiding some body parts. Okay. That bulge shows that he has a penis inside. Okay. If you look at that, if you zoom in and look at the sculpture closely, or in all of these cultures, you'll find a bulge between his thighs. Okay. And this is just from the same age. I'm not even moving to the next century. Okay. This is in Mathura, the red sandstone one. And above, if you see, that is in Kushinagar near Gorakhpur, where Buddha died, where he had his parinirvana. Now, just in the same era, you see his sculpture moving from somebody human, size-wise, ornament-wise, material used-wise, and representation-wise, to something that goes divine and that only increases. The bulge between his thighs is gone. Okay, he is added more and more divine icons. Okay, the bulge on his forehead. That says that, you know, there is a mole on his forehead that is Nishani. So there are some 5-6 features of Buddha that made him superhuman. The thing on top, okay, the hair. He had a large forehead because he was very enlightened. He had earlobes hanging till here. Okay, he had some other markers on his chest. There's a diamond-like thing. Kya bolte hai, main bhool gayi abhi. On his chest, and of course the penis is gone. So this is Bamiyan Buddha, the second one. This is one of the largest statues, the white one. And do you know where it is? That is also a source of anxiety for a lot of people, the location of this place. The second sculpture, the white one, Bamiyan Buddha, is in Afghanistan. It is one of the world's largest.
We have a student from Afghanistan here.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Visa lagwa do, chalte hain ghumne. I am any day ready to go. And the third one is from China, of course. So you see this huge, okay, paranormal deification of this human figure. Right? He goes huge and huge and huge into gold, into whatnot, and it just goes on. There's no stopping it. And the sexuality of Buddha is diminished and being made into feel like somebody super divine who has no sexuality, who has no human desires, who has no place for bodily organs. Okay, that happened to male body, and female body was, of course, the birthing mother was celebrated. Next. Yep. Okay. So, ab society to jaisi hai waisi exist karegi. You can't close your eyes and pretend that everything's as same. So yes, all of these traditions still survived, although on the margins, but they still survived. Okay, women who celebrated their sexuality survived. So this, so another cult was created to basically absorb these kind of women. And these cults were called Yakshini cults. These cults were called as Apsara cults. These cults were called as Devdasi later on. Okay, depiction of Devdasi, depiction of Vaishya basically. Okay. All kinds of prostitutes, all kinds of apsaras. Abhi to divine hi, apsara bhi divine hi hai, divine beauty hai. Abhi prostitute kaise bol de seedha seedha. So, theek hai. Ek mother goddess ho gaya, dusra sexuality ka corner ho gaya, the sexual woman, the desirable woman as the apsara. Now, this is one of the most important sculptures in Indian history. There is nothing like it. Till today, there has been nothing that looks like this has ever been found. And it has a great, great story behind it. So basically, there was a village near Bihar, Ganga ke paas, jahan pe dhobi jo hai. Please let me know if anybody has trouble understanding Hindi. Okay?
It's
please
fine.
Let me know. I'll translate. Okay? Okay. So there was this village of washermen who used to go and ek ghat hota hai na, dhobi ghat. So they used to wash their clothes near that dhobi ghat. And they found har kisi ko ek chikna patthar chahiye hota hai, of course, to, you know, to put the clothes down, to beat them. So one of the ghats, there was this chikna patthar that one of the dhobis used to, you know, wash his things on. So one fine year, what happened was, there was flood, and after the flood, the water receded a little back, okay? And there was apparently a snake in the village that, because of after the flood, there were a lot of snakes that, you know, came in to this side. So they were chasing a snake. That snake went inside this stone and vanished. So they dug up all around the stone to chase the snake, and what you saw as the chikna pathar that the dhobi was using was her back in the second image, you can see. And when they, you know, dug deeper and turned her out, then she was a goddess. Okay, so that's the story of how Didarganj Yakshini was found. They wagged and wagged and wagged her, and then they found her, they turned her around, and she was, of course, what? Mother goddess. She was found and she was immediately deemed as mother goddess. And she was taken to local cult to worship. Ki hamare yahan nikla hai, ye isht devi hai, ab inka puja kiya jayega. So there was this Englishman, Britisher who was given Patna constituency at the time, and he had recently opened Jadugar. Okay, Jadugar is name of Patna museum. So he was looking for something to house in there, something precious, something important. And he came to know that the local villagers have discovered something very exquisite, something that has never been seen before. And then he went there, and of course there was a clash, but they were Britishers. They had India at the time, so they quelled the rebellion. and they took her out and brought her in Patna Museum. And then she gained glory all over the world. She was deemed as one of the most finished, high Mauryan polish, something very aesthetically divine. She was the figure from India. So there's this event called Art Biennale, where the world goes on to represent its best. So in the Biennale in US, in the India Pavilion, she was chosen to represent India. That this is the most exquisite sculpture we can get from India. And while going on, she went there, she was all photographed, achha ho gaya, sab pahunch gaye, khicha gaya. Vaapsi ke time mein, what happened was, there was airplane turbulence. The sculpture fell and her nose was chipped off. Can you see? If you zoom in, her nose is cut off. And that curator lost his life over it. He was sued for millions by the Indian government and basically his career ended. After a grand opening of being the curator of the Biennale, he just went down drains just paying for her nose. And after that, Indian government decreed that she is never going to move from Patna Museum. So now she's caged in 4 glass boxes. There are 4 men with rifles standing all around her and her travels are done. She is not going to move from Patna Museum ever. So if you want to see her, you have to go to Patna Museum. Okay. But yes, Yakshi became the other side of absorbing female sexuality. Okay. There was magic. There was divinity. She was related to the art. So all kinds of other women in society who were not the idealized birthing mother could fit into, were tried to given this option that, okay, if you want to be sexual, be like, be the Yakshi, be the Apsara, be these kind of women. Okay. Next. Yes. And from here starts our perpetual anxiety with the female nude. So in modern art historical productions, it is seen as legitimized entity in Indian art history. Abhi to hamare liye bahut hi legit category hai nude ki. Okay, it is far acceptable. It is modern art, and there's not even a qualm about to talk about it. Contemporary existence mein jo hamare past ke baggages hai now. Now that becomes highly controversial. Okay, it becomes something. Can we come back to this slide after I've shown you Khajuraho? Can we do that?
Yeah. Shall I move to next slide?
Next. Yeah. This one? Basically, here we go. As a matter of national pride, as a matter of handling nudity, female nudity, the female nude body, we have now devised 2 solid plans. One is holiness. Anything that comes out of female nudity has to be something to do with motherhood, birthing status or holiness, okay, or the larger idea of holiness, that she was holy. That's why she went into this. Okay, Akka Mahadevi went in love of Shiva. She went nude because she was holy. She was a saint. Okay, Karakalamyar from Tamil Nadu, she worshipped Shiva as in a ghori form, and she used to live naked because she was holy. Okay, all kinds of love, desire, sexuality is put into 2 categories. The first is, you can see in Lajjavari format. This is also something that you see at Kamakhya. If you visit this kind of female glory, but of course, it is again put into the ideal of the holy. Okay, that it is the holy, it is not female pleasure, it is nothing. She is only birthing or she is holy. Okay, we can't handle vagina without these 2 contexts. And the next is, go to the next slide.
Next slide or picture?
No, next slide. Of course. The holy or the terrible. Okay. So either we fear female sexuality in divinity or we deem it holy. Either it is motherhood or it is Chamunda. It are either, Kali or Durga in their grotesque form or in their motherhood form. Okay. And this creates that the only way you understand female sexuality is through desire and fear. Either it is desirable, either it is deemed necessary through the process of reproduction, through the process of using female organs for fertility, for worship, for motherhood, or by fearing its power of what all divine feminine can do. Okay, so this is Yamuna, Vindhya, and this is Sirantaka. I forgot to caption her. These are all from different yogini sites, yogini temples in India. These two are from MP and Khajuraho. So if you go to Khajuraho, nobody knows this. You were only enticed by the main Shiva temple of the Khajuraho. But just nearby, you will find the earliest located Chausat Yogini temple. There are 64 yogini, and the earliest located temple that we can find in India is in Khajuraho. It's 8th century BC. Okay. So ye beauty and grotesque ka jo idea hai, sirf isi mein hum constantly divide karte hain female sexuality ko. Now yogini comes as a challenge. Okay. The cult of yogini came in the aftermath of Gupta dynasty. Gupta dynasty, if you know, is the era that people call as Bharat jab sone ki chidiya thi. Yeah. So that's Gupta dynasty. And why was it Sone ki Chidiya? Because it was utterly homogenous. It was just like Hindu Rashtra. Okay. It was homogenous. It was upper caste. There was total control that lied with men. Everything was ritual. Everything was sacrificial. Everything was mass produced. Okay, everything was controlled by one single unit, the Gupta dynasty, the all kinds of art production. Okay, and it was heavily censored, heavily oppressive to all kinds of marginal identities, to caste identities. Okay, there were high, caste assaults, caste oppressions, all kinds of gender identities were hunted. So if you see at the location of these yogini temples, location of tantric practices, they're all located in some remote part. Now it has become accessible, but at that time they were all hidden. Khajuraho was a hidden temple where Tantra, they used to practice their tantric rituals through, Madhira, Mats. There are 5 M that are compulsory in Tantra: Madhira, Matsya, Maithun, Mans, and Mantra. Okay, so these are very guided 5 M of, without it cannot take place. And this is the complete idea of Vaishnavite deity. Okay, even Shiva is cleansed up. You see now Shiva all sundar looking, dressed up. Okay, not like the bhang eating, chillam smoking, and dreadlock dancing kind of a crazy guy. Okay, everything is sanitized for the purpose of sanskritization, for the purpose of rewriting history. And these women are all drunken, eating men up for appetite, okay, hunting. So of course they are fearful. They are the other, so they need to be feared. So fear is, instead of worship, they are created as a category of fear. And this fear is located in otherness, all kinds of otherness. Okay, these are not your women that men in Vaishnavite society or Brahminical society will want their wives or daughters to be. This is other, that's why it has to be worshipped, so that you do not become like it. Okay, so here sexuality is a power. All kinds of powers manifest itself through sexuality. Okay, when they are othered, people worship them or revere them so that we do not become like them, or we do not get influenced like them. Same is the identity with in contemporary times, the Hijra identity. Okay, why do you pay transgender? What is it? What is that deep-seated thing that makes you pay a transgender? There is some kind of divinity assigned to them, right? There are all kinds of superstitions and rumors that you hear that, whatever they'll say will come true. They curse you.
Yeah, one of the very common rumors is that ki ye dua karenge to wo kabool hi ho jati hai.
Exactly. And if they don't, if they curse also, that will also come true.
Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah. So sexuality here is a power of the other. So that you do not become like that. Half the audience in India pays them so that our son or daughter or nothing happens to our generation that looks something like this. Half of it is fear. Half of it is guilt. Half of it is, just the otherness. That, okay, thank God, I am not like her. I did not end up with 2 organs. Okay, so sexuality has power. it manifests in otherness, in control, in negotiation, in rewriting of history, in all kinds of things. So knowledge and power are very important to understanding sexuality. That's your Foucault coming in. I hope you'll elaborate more in your classes about this. Now, can we go back to the nude slide? Yes. So these are two kinds of nude to accommodate. Okay. So of course, in both kinds of nude, the depiction of nudity itself is something that gives the Indian patriarchy today high doses of anxiety, right? But even then, how do you neutralize it? So Khajuraho, for example, or other things are neutralized through either fearful sexuality, through this idea of national pride, that it was our culture, it was our pride, and it was a heritage, okay? And it was a tourist site. So either you do this, despite its much argued religious, spiritual, and aesthetic associations, the nude in India has been a continual source of both enigma and unease, given the blurred boundaries between art, religion, and morality. So the ruling classes today, in all senses of the word, the ruling classes in terms of the class identity, caste identity, gender identity, capital, in all senses of the word, how they're still very enigmatic and still very anxious about how to handle sexuality, especially sexuality as part of heritage, sexuality as part of temple worship, sexuality as part of, now you can't deny it, Indian tradition. Okay, so what you need to do is not just reassert Kama Sutra, because every time some censorship or something comes up, people start reasserting Kama Sutra without understanding. If you read the book Kama Sutra, you'll find out how patriarchal it is. That it's, yes, it depicts sexual positions of all kinds, of pleasures of all kinds. But it, in the end, it says that you're only doing this to please your husband. Okay, this is how you can be a good woman to your husband, if you practice these. So there are all kinds of traditions and nuances in our heritage. What to use, what to not use, what to preserve, and what to preserve from being rewritten is the most political act you can do right now. Okay? Of what knowledge to preserve and get along? Of what part of history? They claim something as history, and then you show them that this existed as well. What kind of history is being dominated, is being rewritten, is being celebrated, versus what is being left out, what is being erased, what is being consciously attacked and demonized? And that's where all of this material comes into being, that you definitely need to start researching on. Okay? Yeah. Aage. After this. Yes. So this is the third category. The beautiful, the motherhood, okay, the goddess figure, the female, the cult of the female goddess was first. The grotesque and the other sexuality of the other that has to be feared, that has to do with tantra, is the other. The third kind is the sexual. Now here there are no black bodies, there are no meat-eating women, they are ideal beauties. Okay, they're so ideal that they are not even real bodies. Real bodies cannot have, you know, waist that thin and breast that huge. Okay, it's impossible to have these kind of bodies, to have these kind of postures. But, and that is why it is the ideal world. This is the fantasy world. This is the ideal sexual world. And it just, there is no goddess, there is no cult, there is no giving birth to anyone. There is only and only pleasure. Now, how do you handle something like this? This is the biggest thorn in the eyes of Hindu Rashtra. How do you handle something that is so on face, that is homosexual, that is, I don't know, pansexual, that is orgy, that is all kinds of sexual expression on your face? There's no subtlety to it. There's no metaphor to it. Okay, it's right there. Now, how do you handle something like this? How do you talk about something like this? Any views, any starting comments on this?
Ma'am, actually, I wanted to ask you something a while back. So can we say that whatever it is, be it viewing a woman as either a deity on one hand, or the sexual part even, whatever happens, it's this dichotomy between subject and object, wherein woman always gets treated as the object, be it the object of devotion or the object of male gaze.
Yeah. So what's your question?
So
is there something
would be no no so we would be justified in analyzing this like that, right? That a woman, no matter whether she's an object of devotion or an object of sexual pleasure, she's always an object. The basic entity that she has is as an object.
Okay. Look at the first painting right here, above. Do you think a male gaze would have pleasure from this? Heterosexual,
no, ma'am.
Male gaze would derive a pleasure from this?
No,
ma'am. Do you think a homoerotic woman or a lesbian woman would derive pleasure from the second painting that is below? The four women wala, second painting jo left mein niche hai. Do you think a lesbian, a heterosexual man, a lesbian, a bisexual, all of them would derive pleasure from this one?
No, ma'am. All of them wouldn't.
Why do you say that?
Ma'am, I was thinking about the homosexual man. So if these
I
all
say homosexual, be... that's what I'm saying. I didn't say the homosexual man.
Oh yeah, okay, then they except, would they would I like it's just a representation of women having intercourse.
Yeah, humko character banana hai. So second painting mein, who all are the gender categories, the sexual categories, sexual orientation of gender categories, who would enjoy pleasure from the second painting? A bisexual woman, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, of course.
Yes. A heterosexual man, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
A homosexual woman, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
A homosexual man, yes or no?
No, ma'am.
A bisexual man, yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
What do we have here? We have, you have said yes to four things. And three
yes,
of
ma'am.
Them involve women.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So three of them involve women seeking pleasure from watching at this. So now is she a subject or an object or both?
Both, ma'am, in this case.
Yeah. So
yeah.
See, the relationship between subject and object depends on how you see desire. You can't, I can... Okay, a homosexual man can desire this. Desire is not, you know, is not synonymous to the word of your sexual preference. Desire is something else. Yeah? Don't heterosexual men watch lesbian porn? Why do they do this? There's no purpose. Doesn't fulfill anything. But it serves the purpose of desire, purpose of gaze. So just by looking at the object, you can, yes, talk about the object in itself, whether the object, what kind of a relationship is the object offering you, whether that object is offering you pleasure, whether it's offering you fear, whether it doesn't even care that you exist, okay? That we can talk about, but we can't talk about the objective analysis of how we look at painting, of what kind of audience desire and, you know, sexuality is within the eyes of our gaze, is within the eyes of the gaze of the person watching the object. So what do you do? Okay, theek hai, ek object hai, ek subject rahega. How do you historically subvert it? Through this. That she's not catering to your gaze. She exists in her own realm. She doesn't care. She's having her own pleasure looking at two women and already being inside a man's penis. She's having all the world by herself and she doesn't care. She's giving her back to you.
Am okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
So it's not that always women will be the subject of gaze. Okay. It's also that how do they answer to that gaze? How do they take back power? And whether the audience now itself comprises of women. Yeah, that's how you subvert power hierarchies. That gaze is not entirely heterosexual. That's its protest. This gaze is not entirely heterosexual. That's the protest. The first painting is not even entirely human. I'm not sure what they're doing with whatever that is. I saw this painting live there and I was blushing like hell. I couldn't stop blushing. I had never seen something like this. Like, I've studied this all my life.
Where is this painting from, the first one? It looks like a horse or something.
When you enter Khajuraho, before entering, there is this toran, okay, on the wall. There is this huge wall that you have to cross to reach the main shrine. And on that wall, you will find crazy stuff. Iske bagal mein pata hai kya ho raha hai? I cropped this photo. Iske bagal mein, there are two men who are... I have that photo, sorry, I'll post it. It's in my archives, the one I photographed. There are two men who are crushing something in an oak leaf.
Okay.
And I was like, what is happening? I couldn't make sense of at all. Ye ho kya raha hai? Gadha bhi hai, ghoda bhi hai, insaan bhi hai, koi latak raha hai, koi chad raha hai, bagal mein koi kuch koot raha hai. So I was like, what is he crushing? And then my friend said, Viagra maybe. That's what they need. That's what's missing. But you look at all of these. How do you handle something like this? How do you handle something like this in Hindu Rashtra? Yeah? One woman, five men. Look at the... Can you see the painting on the extreme... Jo sabse chota hai, extreme right above?
Mm-hmm.
You can see two women masturbating.
Yeah.
So how do you handle something like that? Okay, there is heterosexual gaze in between. There is a couple making love. There is methun happening. But how do you handle side mein kya ho raha hai?
This is too voyeuristic as well.
Yeah, so we'll come to that. Very interesting point. Voyeurism.
Yeah. Okay. Shall I move ahead?
Next. Iske baad kya hai? Ek baar jaana zara. Let me see if I want. Yes. Thank you. Okay. So, now, let's come to the point. Now, itna predictable hai na Indian janta ki unko pata hai ki agar bahar tum ye dikha do, to peeche kya hai, peeche tumhara credit card number hai, you won't switch it. You won't do anything. The audience is so predictable. So, hum surface pe khajurao ko kaise celebrate karte hai as an expression of sexuality. Right? As an out-and-out voyeuristic expression of sexuality, homoerotic, homoromantic, whatever, all kinds of expressions of sexuality. But what we miss into gaining perspective into Khajuraho is our understanding of Tantra. This is a Tantric temple. Why are they doing this? What are they getting by doing this? So if you put something as it's like an ad, na. Tum laptop kholo side mein ye wala ad aata rahega, to bagal mein se kuch bhi ho raha hoga, tumhara dhyan hi nahi jayega. It is so on your face. Sex has been used to sell anything for ages, right? Whereas if you take out each of these compositions, each of these sculptures, okay, the most guarded thing in Tantra were mantra and mandala, okay? And if you take out each of these compositions and lay them, okay, there is a proper design that leads to a mandala, that leads to answering and protecting and, you know, revealing that mantra. And methun is the union of the forces, masculine and feminine forces of the world. It is about pleasure, it is about desire, but understanding body in Tantricism versus understanding body in Vaishnavism, in Shaivism is completely different things. In Tantric philosophy, the Shiva and Shakti are meeting to have a cosmic union of pleasure. This is the most challenging thing to Hinduism. What does Hinduism say? That everything is homogeneous, everybody is Hindu, everybody can is equal. Basically, it's like a citizen. You're born in India, you're a citizen. So if you're born here, you're a Hindu. Whereas in reality, these two cults have completely two ideological views. Vaishnavism teaches you, be pure, be virginal, celebrate the mother goddess, be the good woman of patriarchy. Okay, do not eat meat. Be pure, be clean. Do not engage in drugs. Do not engage in like all kinds of, you know, purity rituals are involved. Whereas what does Tantra tell you? Tantra tells you, yaar, madira matsya methun. Madira khao, matsya khao. Yeah, madira piyo, matsya khao. Methun karo. Methun is active penetration sex. Mithun is romance, erotic love. Okay? It says that have all kinds of pleasures because body is the tool to seek this pleasure and then control this pleasure. Okay? Your salvation is through this pleasure. If you, your body is the tool, and if you want to experience this world and the divine within this world, what does Vaishnavism tell you? Ki jo kar rahe ho, ye life mein karo, baad mein paap punya milega. Right? You will get rewarded after life, whether you succeeded or not. Shaivism is saying whatever happens, Tantricism is here. It is in this body, it is right now, it is through these five senses, it is through this body. So seek pleasure as much as you can and learn to control it. That's when you become a yogi and a yogini. When you can control your pleasure. When you can harness the divine within yourself. And that's why the use of bodily fluids, the use of menstrual blood is a very recurring thing in this. So erotic is not just an expression, okay, in Khajurao. Erotic is ideological. They knew that if anybody finds what we are doing here, they are going to destroy it. So just give them on their faces cultures of lovemaking so that they can have voyeuristic pleasures from it. And while they get lost, we are protecting our mantras and our mandalas through this composition. They will never even come close to finding it. Because nobody can see beyond it. Nobody will cross it. It is so beautiful. It is so ideal. So this was the strategy adopted by a lot of Tantric temples. It's not just here. If you visit a lot of places in Ladakh, in Nepal, because Tantra later fled, it was defeated here, so it fled to the upper corners in the northeast. Okay, if you go to all of these places, you'll find similar sculptures. In Nepal, you will find all of Kama Sutra in every temple.
So Soumya.
Yeah.
सवा चार हो गया. सो कैन वी जस्ट चूज द स्लाइड्स दैट यू वांट दैट यू थिंक आर इम्पोर्टेंट.
ठीक है. ओके, वी कैन डू दैट.
दिस वन,
देन आई थिंक वील स्किप अष्टनायिका. देन दैट्स नॉट इम्पोर्टेंट. सो आफ्टर दिस लेट मी जस्ट क्विकली इंट्रोड्यूस व्हाट एन अष्टनायिका इज. आफ्टर दिस द कॉम्पोजिशन ऑफ द मेजर code of conduct, okay, that we see that women are being divided into something. Because now you have to acknowledge that they are heroines, they have love, they have desire. Now you're entering a different century, different time. A lot of cultures are getting mixed up. So no longer can you control female desire. So what do you do then? You compose something called as Nayak Nayika Bhed. In Natya Shastra, women are divided into 8 kinds of heroines. And these are based on several things, okay? They're in either in separation, either in union. They are either their own women, they are either married to the Nayak, or they are Anyastri. So Anyastri, if you can see the second last point here, is the single widow or the wife of other. And Gadika Sadharan is the Vaishya, is the Tawayaf, is the last woman who is adept in art. They are sanctioned to learn the art. They're highly read. They're poetesses. And but they are deemed not worthy of marriage or not worthy of assigning this idea of good women by saying that they only do this for money. They don't care about love. They hate the virtuous. They don't behave like the virtuous woman. So women are divided into these 8 categories. And why are we doing this today? Because Ashtanayika is still the idea of heroine that Indian cinema uses today. all of your films still base their ideas of Naikas on these divisions. They still reaffirm that, represent that, derive from this very same idea of division of women. Okay, I can send the slide, and I've put in links of each Naika and their representation in Bollywood. So I think you can go through that. I think you can skip this, the Ash Naika part. Or aage aao, niche. Yeah, wo division hai sara, aur hai. These are 8 kinds of Naikas, their representation in art and in cinema. Aur niche, aur niche. These are all Naikas. Iske bhi niche. Yep, yep, nahin. Upar, upar, thoda sa upar. Where we start Mughal, iske upar. Iske upar, yes, okay. Okay, so after this, we arrive to the Mughal era, which again is a source of contention, source of anxiety for contemporary times. Why? Because it had a very, very open view, very, very nuanced view of sexuality. And one of the most nuanced paintings of sexuality that we experience, of course, there is again this motherhood, goddess, beauty, sexuality, ye sab hai. Akbar ke time se hi hai, Babar ke time bhi hai, Humayun ke time bhi hai. But it thrives to a different level of nuance at the time of Jahangir. Because Jahangir, as some of you might know, was the connoisseur of art and experimented sexually. He was bisexual. His wife, Noor Jahan, was also bisexual. And they commissioned paintings to be to record moments where there are women who is making him touch their breast and saying, do something, and he's drunk. He can't do anything. No ruler in history of India till now has represented himself like this ever in painting, paid money for it to be captured. That I am so in a moment of impotency, I am so drunk, or I am so infertile or weak or non-masculine, okay, that I can't satisfy a woman, and there is this harem of women demanding my energy. Okay. So this is one of the paintings. The first one that you see is Jahangir sitting in his harem and Noor Jahan offering him opium. So this is full on party going on. Yeah, and all kinds of themes. Here you will see in Jahangir paintings in the era that were made in Jahangir Nama's time, you will see all kinds of representation of sexuality. You will see homoerotic love, you will see gay love, you will see hijra love, you will see all kinds of love. All kinds of expressions are given, all kinds of bodies are given spaces, all kinds of pleasures are given spaces. Okay? But again, the anxiety, because they also have to balance it. So the second one is from Ramayana paintings. So Ramayana is one such text, one such story that cannot be avoided by any ruler at any time. It had such huge popularity in local culture and in several ways. So of course, Ramayana had to be commissioned, but Sita was commissioned, not portrayed as this, you know, as this bridal Rajput queen, but she was, in Mughal painting, she looked more like Mughal princesses or Rajputs, wearing dresses like them, feeling like them, you know, expressing desires like her, most importantly, the desire of separation and love. And Hamida Bano Begum loved her because she and Humayun spent several years in exile, as you might know. And of course, they had very difficult times. Humayun was only able to rule 2 years after coming back. And Akbar also had a very difficult childhood. So she really associated herself with Sita. And at the time of Akbar and Jahangir, more than 3 imperial Ramayanas were commissioned in 3 different styles made by painters and masters from 3 different times. Okay. Can we go? Yeah. Yeah. So this, the woman on the left is Noor Jahan, wife of Jahangir, and this is the time, so portraits start coming into being. And portraits give us a huge sense of how one imagines themselves. This is a Mughal empress, and she doesn't look like one. She doesn't look anything feminine. She doesn't look anything that is catering to male gaze, or you know, or the bride of Jahangir. She is cleaning her gun. She is going for hunting. She is taking care of the entire realm. She literally had all the stamps that, you know, that need to be, that needed to go the royal stamp, that needed to sanction everything. So in Mughal times, you see a completely different idea of love, sexuality, romance, and bodies as it is projected till now. Okay, they will tell you ki bhaiya burke mein hogi, 10 feet parde ke piche koi aurat, sab samajhna wo Mughal era ki hai. But this is Noorjahan wearing a man's clothes, having a gun, cleaning up. Doesn't need a man in her life ever. Yeah, she doesn't need in it. Painting, she is stand by alone, a woman in herself, a very androgynous figure, a very embracing masculinity figure, right? Whereas second one is a Rajput depiction of the Naika that is waiting for her lover, for her husband to arrive. And here you see, yeah, of course, she's Vasak Sajja, she's getting ready before the lover arrives. But we don't know, because the painter has portrayed it in such a clever way that we don't know if the lover is the lover or the husband or the other. So that's the cheat here. That, you know, it makes the audience look like she is somebody who is a freshly, you know, freshly married woman waiting for the husband. But we don't know. And that's the cheat. That's the desire. That's the resistance that they've put up. And these two women they're in that space. This is completely a painting again that, of course, caters to male desire. That gives you a peek into a space where you shouldn't be supposed to be. And that gives a different kind of pleasure, you know, to get into a space where you can't be. So visual metaphors are used to play, subvert, and introduce all kinds of desire into the realm of sexuality. Okay, how it was perceived. Can we go next? Yeah. So this is Balwant Singh. He's a guy I would like to be friends with, but yeah, in some other world. Can you zoom in a little bit? Neeche se. Not the painting, neeche jo zoom ka option hota hai na. To look at the guy behind him.
Okay.
Yeah, he's just, yes, thank you. Okay, theek hai, this is okay.
Is fine?
Yeah. So, not my students, anybody else who wants to tell me what they're looking at? Why are we looking at this painting in the context of sexuality? Any ideas? Anything that you see here? Any clues?
He's right.
They look like they had sex.
Who is this?
This is Geet.
Okay, Geet, why are you saying that?
Because the guy in front is sitting naked writing something, and the guy at the back is simply just tucking in his clothes or her clothes. And it just looks very like they're done with a very casual thing.
Yeah. So you're absolutely right. So Balwant Singh is this sweet guy jiske paas sare bigde hue mughalon ke bacche aur rajputon ke bacche maal peene jaate hain. Himachal mein rehta hai ye, iske paas ki badhiya camping vamping karta hai, sab log dukhiyon ke isi ke paas aate hain. Okay, so as a reward also, they also bring in their painters. Jahangir, so wherever he went to have anything, he would take his painters. So of course he needed to. So the painter is also high all the time, by the way. If you ever get the chance to study Mughal art with me, you will know why. You'll see it visually. Okay, something, sub pattern and sub symmetry, a beat was which a jeev ho raha hota hai. So they leave records of their being substance, you know, influence. But this painting is very important because it is a source of anxiety for a lot of people. This guy is half Mughal, half Rajput. So, पहले तो इसका existence ही problematic है, ठीक है? दूसरा इसने टोपी लगाया हुआ है, okay? So it's like it looks like a candid photograph. You know, you just had sex and somebody came and he was like cheese and he's like रुक जा कपड़ा रख लेंगे. Can you see that moment? Like, wait, let me just put something on my erected penis so that they can't see. Yeah? And hookah and everything is still there. No time to remove it. So, it is a painting. Isko banane mein kam se kam 10 din lage honge. And it was drawn later on. They might have just done a sketch. But what was the need to record all of this? To record somebody in such a vulnerable stage. And to give him money to do that. Okay? Balwant Singh was a known bisexual. Like, more homosexual, but of course, matlab, he married and he kept the illusion that, okay, I am bisexual. But everywhere in all of these texts and adventures and travelers, they have recorded that he was a very known, like, people knew that he was homosexual. And homosexuality was a pretty accepted thing. Jahangir himself was bisexual, so it wasn't the problem. And look at that guy, look at his hands, look at his hand, both his hands in pleasure. He's a nobody, he's not a center. They're portraying the lover and the beloved, okay? That I can't take you out of my life. You are here to stay and you will go down in history. Otherwise, he looks like somebody non-important. He doesn't look like somebody royal as a figure of authority. But he has been recorded nevertheless and paid money for it. Why did he want to do that? And he is in a state of complete and utter dilemma about the self-image and the self. Who am I versus what am I going to present myself as? Right? So this is one of the most important paintings that portrays homosexuality in a very desire, love, confusion of identity, okay, maybe power over each other, identity, symbols, all kinds of things are present in this painting. And so it is a very nuanced painting that has come out of the Mughal era and gives us a picture of how sexuality was understood or painted or preserved. This painting is preserved. It wasn't destroyed or censored after anybody came to power. That also says a lot. Yeah. And after, of course, this, we entered into, I don't know, Victorian ideology, Victorian morality. And censorship started taking place. There was, of course, Raja Ravi Verma and the likes, but they did nothing very substantial. The only revolt they did was they painted women they loved into the images of goddesses, which was, again, something that feared them. But a lot of it also came with this idea of industrialization, with this idea of capital, with women's bodies as commodities now, with women's bodies as a product of labor that can have an exchange value, you know, not just as gays, not just as religious objects. So the anxiety continues. On one hand, we start to celebrate. This is the emblematic, this is the most celebrated art form. But when we portray it in cinema, so M.S. Hussain made this film, Rajagamini, if I don't know if you've seen it or not, but it was a huge disaster. It was a huge Bollywood disaster because of this anxiety with sexuality, of this appropriate, how can a Muslim man take Khajurao and make something with the most iconic diva of the time? Okay. This is just like purely unacceptable to the Victorian morality, to anything that the censorship or the state authority understood, right? But till now, it has just been, even in Indian cinema, yes, there are some moments that are coming out that take us to the early Ajanta cave of that idea of female desire, that, you know, desire for itself, desire not towards something but inward, desire as existence, you know, sexuality as experience of pleasure of this world, of within this body, of different bodies, okay? So we haven't arrived there yet. Till now, we are just replicating the Ashtanayika. We are still using, even for subversion, even for resistance, we are using sexuality as a political tool, as a tool of one versus the other, okay? You give me the good woman, you give me Sita, and I will give you, you know, somebody highly engaged in Kama Sutra. And all the different kinds of sexualities within this range is gone, okay? And it is only in the Western paintings, in surrealism, in movements like that, in Frida Kahlo's painting, that we see a different version of human desire itself, a different version of how females see their bodies, okay, how they want to represent it, experience the world around it. So the last thing that I want to do, I'm skipping the nationalistic, the contemporary time, the nationalism era, entirely because you are born in it. You pretty much know about it. There's nothing new to it. But I want to give you some perspective into how the idea has changed into viewing female bodies now. Next slide.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Could you please elaborate just a little bit about the Dali painting, one by Salvador Dali? The 42nd slide one.
Yeah, so I'll get there. It's after this. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So even within the surrealist movement, there has been a lot of anxiety about who paints who. Okay. These are both paintings by surrealist women artists, women painters. Who want to, no, the first one is by a male painter and by George Doer, and the second one is by a female painter. So please tell me what you see. Any idea, any feelings that come to mind, anything that comes to mind by looking at this? A subject, object, gaze, anything?
The second one, like, where the eyes are in her hand, it looks as if it tries to portray vanity.
Yeah, okay.
In the olden days, it would be like a self-portrait in front of mirror. How do I look? But this is a completely different take on that.
So you're saying selfie kind of a thing.
Yeah, maybe a kind of a selfie in technocratic terms, yeah.
And what does it mean in terms of gaze?
It means like it has everything to do with how you look and how you are going to be perceived by the other, rather than like you turn your camera into your other, and just the shot lets you know whether you are looking good, whether you are looking beautiful, whether you are looking ugly. So about the frame.
Anybody else, anything to say about any of these two paintings?
Ma'am, I would like to go along with what sir was saying, just that I have a little bit of a different take on it. I feel that it's a woman who wants to see, like, she just wants to be the way she is, but that is not for anyone else. That's just for her. So she's just trying to look at herself as, let's say, a third person point of view, or something similar to that, but it's not associated, according to me, with anyone else or with the way that anyone else would be perceiving her, and it would not be affecting her as such. She would be the way she wants to be, the way she is, and she just wants to gaze at herself and appreciate herself.
Okay. So as you know, surrealism was a movement born out of a lot of violence, a lot of understanding of violence, a lot of that, you know, it's not real. The whatever is happening around us, all kinds of oppression, labor, war, pandemic, okay, all kinds of things, it's surreal. It cannot be depicted in the way we have understood reality till now. We have understood ourselves in reality till now. So we need to go beyond it. Okay. So what one of the two major key points in this painting is the rope attached from the breast and shaping her face, something like her face, right? Which in itself is a political commentary on my face doesn't matter. This is all you care about. Okay. My breast is going to define how I look like. So you can portray your gaze. I know that you will look at me with that gaze, with that desire, with that object-like gaze. But my eyes are here now. I am a postmodern woman. My eyes are in a place where I can see you looking at me and also desire myself for who I am. So it's not a narcissistic gaze only. It's not a gaze only to admire oneself or to look oneself, a very retrospective gaze. It is also a critical gaze. It is also commenting. The eyes are placed in such a direction that you look at me and I look at you. Why should I give you the authority to look at myself and have pleasure?
This is the Satrian look.
Yeah. So the gaze is being returned. The gaze is being returned while looking inside. And this is precisely what I call as the feminine voice in surrealism, in painting. That a new kind of articulation of being, of looking at body, of looking at gaze, of looking at sensations around us are coming in. That it's not just reciprocation. It's not that, you know, your power I have taken, I have become me, I'm returning the gaze. So it's not male gaze versus female gaze. It's cultivating a gaze that looks both inside and outside, both with criticality and with admiration for self. Okay. The second one, in fact, the nude on the doorway. Any comments about that?
Ma'am, I think this painting represents the release of female sexuality, of how the whole body is simply flowing on the surface. I don't know, it looks like the female orgasm to me, like it's representing the female orgasm.
And from that, can you tell the gender of the painter?
I think it would be to be a man.
And why do you say that?
Because of the pictorial representation of the orgasm. Of how it's represented.
That is exactly the point, but I want to dig deeper. Tell me, what is the pictorial representation a man has of a woman's orgasm? This is a question I'm highly interested in.
Looking to be all materialistic, of how it's simply just flowing out and it's simply as release and not something which is emotional or something. Like it doesn't have any deeper connection. Like they are categorizing or connecting this female orgasm or the female release with the same as being a release of a man or a man having a release.
Exactly. So see, you have it there. This is exactly the difference, even in surrealism, which is a movement to defy all of that, which is a movement to defy perception, to challenge dogma, to challenge existing status quo, to challenge even fascism at times, or political abstraction. Here is a very gendered way, still in surrealism, within which the painters portray female body and the women portray female body. It is exactly that. It is very symmetrical. It is designed. It has no fluidity. The fluidity is the conception only considered with, you know, the feminine release. And that body, okay, fine, you have twisted the body to make it look like very androgynous, male or female or I don't know what. But still, it's not comfortable. I don't know if it's something that women would not enjoy. They would not want to look at themselves like this. It's a very strict adherence to a female figurine that is emerging from somewhere. And the gaze itself, the gaze is the angle. If you look at the angle in which she's being seen, it's not an angle where you would see yourself. It's not a retrospective angle. It's like, I am the god, I've been in the best chair and I... Yeah, it's a cinematic gaze.
Yeah,
cinema mein, so cinematic gaze question karna kyun zaruri hai? Kyunki cinema mein audience is given the gaze of the god, that what characters cannot see for themselves in the story, you get to see that from above, this godlike thing. Okay, next. Now we come to a more nuanced understanding of male-female union, of understanding of erotic love, romantic love, desire. Anything that you see in this painting, this is a postmodern man and a woman, post-enlightenment, who have understood things, who have engaged into discourses, who now go to universities, who attain, you study about art and civilization and all kinds of things, and still they are struggling with something. What is it?
There's something really like very paradoxical in this expanding. Okay, the one that we are seeing right now. The left one is the male, isn't it?
Mm.
His face is there. And the voids or the dark spaces and the sky can be seen through his skull.
Mm.
Okay, so this is usually the place which head is usually the place which is associated with mind. Isn't it? Like usually. This part of the body is the most dominating part of the body, and it is where thought resides. On the other hand, the female, she has those holes or whatever ruptures in her body, rather than
heart. The place heart is.
Rather than her head, like her head has only a bit of it. And her head seems more intact rather than the man's. I don't know what it depicts. Like, I'm not very good at reading art. This is just something which stuck me.
No, but you're on point. You're exactly right. And mostly what we see and feel are affect. If we acknowledge that affect, it's mostly right. Anybody, anything else? What do you feel? Okay, don't tell me analysis, philosophy. Tell me what do you feel. When
you look at it. Tell her what do you feel. Kya lagta hai? Bhakti?
Healing.
I'd like to say something, man.
Yeah.
Okay.
This personally looks like to me like because Dali has given some kind of flow to the painting, like the wind is blowing from the women to the men itself. So it's like the woman is being destroyed and the man is being created, like because the wind is facing is flowing from right to left. So it's look like the woman is being reconstructed or is being destroyed and man is simply being created.
Or recreated.
And how the woman's body is being destroyed or the mind itself is being destroyed simply so the man's head can be formed.
Very, very on point. We'll talk about this. Keep this in mind. It is exactly real. Any of my Nalayak students, would you like to speak up? We're about to end up. Sachin, Suprasanna, Sakshi, tell me what do you see?
Anyone else from other students? Bhakti, Ira, Husseini?
Ayan? Bolo yaar. Otherwise, so you guys are non-stop. यहाँ पे चुप हो गए हो. What do you feel?
There are only two or three students of yours. I guess some Suprasanna and Sachin. These are the only two there.
Yeah. Where are you guys? Sachin?
Yeah, hello.
Speak up.
Yeah, I agree with the previous speaker. It's about,
very
about
much.
Like completing the man's head from the woman,
What do you feel?
The overall, like, it reminds me of emptiness, like, you know, there's something about emptiness in it, and you know, they're trying their own ways to maybe fill it.
Okay.
Mama, I agree with the words the previous student said, but I have one confusion in this. Why is the women placed on something which looks very similar to a platform?
We call it the pedestal.
Yes. So,
why is she placed? And nothing about her composition. I taught you few classes ago. Kaise dekhte hai painting? Nobody is mentioning the size of the two people.
Yes, ma'am.
So, how we look at paintings, there are a lot of ways and techniques to study that. But one of the major things we do that is by also looking at what kind of size one has been afforded, what kind of space in a painting one has been afforded. And if you see the woman is, although she's giving away the heart, she's bearing the brunt of the wind, as you say, she's on a pedestal because she's taking the maximum toll, the maximum work within capitalism, within patriarchy, within labor, within all sectors of life. And for doing that, she is seated on a pedestal again as a goddess, as something to be feared for, as something you want in your life, basically. But as a protector also, but ho kya raha hai usse? Abhi bhi?
Mardi ban raha hai.
Mardi ban raha hai, par again, both of them are incomplete.
Yeah.
Both of them are adhe adhure. Both of them are, this is not the union of the masculine and the feminine. This is again, the world taking away the femininity from the man and the masculinity or the heart or the feeling or something away from a woman. Okay. So surrealism is depicting that. In fact, Dali has been quite invested in this philosophy of what capitalism does to both women's and man's bodies. And also, of course, the man needs to be constructed at all costs. And so, still the man is empty. Even
Ira,
after
Ira wants to say something.
Yeah.
Ma'am, in addition to the size of the man and the woman, I was also trying to understand the positioning that is happening here. The woman is at the background, the man is in the front, and
the woman has body and the man has head.
Yeah. So and I was also thinking that, you know, in a way, putting the woman on the pedestal and you know, it's just a way of actually keeping her in the background, and this understanding that, you know, I'm a successful man kyunki meri biwi bahut support kar rahi hai, but in that process of supporting, she loses herself. She's not even she's not herself anymore. So that is what I felt.
Exactly. So remember, in the nude slide, the last point was that all the contestation of all kinds of power, patriarchy, capitalism, religion, romance, desire, sex, all kinds of things, all kinds of power negotiations are taking place over women's bodies, over their labor, over their identities. And even after that, because patriarchy is not sustainable, because it can be easily challenged, because masculinity is highly fragile. And even after taking away all of that, this man is still empty. This man is also still incomplete. So as long as this kind of exchange is highly toxic, this kind of attitude of seeing the world is highly toxic, it is unequal. And that is why this painting is pushing us towards that equilibrium, that equality. Where is the imagination of the equality? When will these two halves be more in union, in sync? When the man works on his heart, on his emotions, on his bodily labor, right? And the woman increases her size, reclaims her space, get out of that pedestal where she has been placed as the woman to be worshipped, the woman to be feared, to be protected, and reclaim her identity. Take that gaze. That gaze that looks you in the eye, questions you, as well as accepts self. This painting is highly spiritual as well, because it takes a lot from all the concepts of, you know, the ardhanari, the body in itself, which requires the masculine and feminine forces to be reckoned with, the yin and yang, right? The equality of citizens in capitalism. It is pushing you towards that. It is saying what all is wrong and where should you go. It is giving you the answer to the question. Am I making sense?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
And the last one is, now the postmodern world, what has it done to masculinity? How are men suffering? What is the imagination of male bodies, male desire under this? A postmodern man who is enlightened, who is woke, who is feminist, and still can't reckon with his traditional gender training, still can't get over his cultural training, his bodily desires, his shortcomings, and, you know, his rationality that he has the power over everything. How to choose to give up that power? How to handle hate? How to handle pain? Okay, if we move on to the next painting, you'll see all of this. Can we do that, Muzaffar? And that's the end.
This is the that's it.
Yeah, that's the last painting.
Yeah. It's already there.
हाँ हाँ ठीक है तो मतलब हाँ बताइए क्या लग रहा है देखते हैं I can't see it something wrong here please please go on describe it to me I have it over my laptop I'll open it here what yeah. do you think what is this painting doing about patriarchy what is it telling us about men imagination of a male body in postmodern postcolonial capitalism fascistic approaching fascistic world
sir will it be possible to zoom in just a little I'm actually watching it on the phone so I can't
okay so let me give you a hint ek saath mat dekho paintings ko let's first talk about space What do you think is the imagination of space in three paintings? If you have to space, maan lo isko cinema mein tumhe kisi location pe shoot karna hoga. What will be the three locations?
So the middle one is somewhere in a building in front of a staircase.
Theek hai. Home entry exit
yeah maybe
actually the way I see these pictures is like you know the what do you call it the processing line on which different products go through different phases and they get made so if we I was actually seeing it from the side where there is a portrait complete almost and then it goes through this middle phase wherein there is some kind of reconstruction or else we could go from the left side that there is a very ambiguous gender role firstly then in the second picture we can see that that gender role is being built upon and finally in the last stage I feel that we have arrived at this place wherein there's a very very fixed gender role for someone who is biologically a male so that's the way I interpreted it
very nice that's one of the most important element of each of these paintings that of course you have to see them one after the other and she's right I want more words philosophical words This is your domain.
There is some sort of transformation going on.
Sir, rather than calling it transformation, I would rather call it construction, like
deconstruction.
Like identity. No, sir. I was thinking about identity construction. The way that biological sex gets associated with gender.
But here it's not getting constructed for the first time. There is already a construct which, according to the postmodern way, for example, following Derrida, will be deconstructed. There will be reshuffling.
Sir, I actually also did think about the reshuffling part. I was actually thinking on the lines of androgyny or something like that. But looking at the pictures the way I did, I really don't. I put that thought aside because okay. The central picture, if we see it, it's still in line with the traditional concept or the traditional way of looking at men. That's why I did not go with the reconstruction part of it.
Okay, interesting. Anybody else? Anything you have to say about emotions?
Actually, I was coming to that part. I mean, to the emotions part, where in the first image, if you look carefully, it feels more like the person has been bogged down, and you know, there's a lot of pressure or something. But you know, just in order to show that there's nothing happening, there's one kind of what do you say? covering up happening on the thing, on the emotions part, because he's a male and males are not supposed to express the, like, are not supposed to be too emotional, and that is how the transformation that is taking to the second place. And also the fact, I don't know what it is, but I see that that shows some kind of muscular power or something. And since the males are associated with this image of being physically more powerful, or, you know, and the third image, I don't know what the resemblance of mirror is, but it seems more like an ego image to me, that, you know, that ego is formed and it cannot be broken down if you express emotions, or if I could, you know. That is how I interpret it, if I was clear.
Okay. So, one of the... anybody else? Anything else? See, if you take just each word to interpret this painting ideologically, you can do that, okay? You can just use the word patriarchy, go from one painting to other. You can just use the word emotion, you can go from one to other. You can use the word capitalism, interpret in a different light. You can use religion and go in a different light. You can use all kinds of things to interpret this painting, and all of them are true. There is no one interpretation that stands above the other. But I want to offer you something that is ingrained in the historical moment as well, which is the wound, the metaphor of the wound. Okay. So the wound is something, the metaphor of the wound is very important to understanding masculinity. It's very important to understand, I think, all kinds of historical oppressive systems that come back constantly. Why does patriarchy sustain itself? How does it sustain itself? How does any oppressive power that is oppressive, that we know it is oppressive, how does it sustain itself? Why is it still thriving? What's the answer? Why is patriarchy still thriving? Or why isn't everyone revolting? Why are some people revolting and some not? Because all kinds of these systems, all kinds of oppressive powers do not just annihilate, do not just restrict the other, do not just control the other, do not just are dogmatic, or, you know, or are hierarchical, or classify, or put you into genres, but they also give you a sense of self, right? Patriarchy divides women into good women and bad women. So it gives you a strong sense of self. If you are ready to embrace that sense of self, if you are an obedient wife, if you are a dutiful, loyal wife, if you are a dutiful daughter, then you are rewarded in patriarchy. If you are not, then you are punished. It's always Sita versus Urdhvanaka, right? Do you express your desire or do you sacrifice? What virtues are rewarded? What virtues are sacrificed? In all kinds of systems, okay? Now, why does it keep coming back though? Because patriarchy is that fragile that it can be challenged with a man walking in skirt on street. It's not a regimented system. And that is, because it is a social construct, because it is performative, it can be challenged by re-performing or subverting or performing the opposite. If you perform the opposite, the status quo is challenged constantly. Okay? But the wound remains. If you don't address the wound of patriarchy, if you don't address the wound of communalism, India has had a wound of communalism since partition. We have never addressed it. We have never given it a recognition in our bodies. We have never given us time to mourn, to grieve, to stand as a witness, to, you know, have a national memory of that event. And that's why it constructively comes back in history to haunt us again and again and again. Comes back in 92, in 2002, it comes back again and again till now. It's similar with patriarchy, about the ego issue, about the masculinity, that the wounds that patriarchy has created, both within men and women, about understanding themselves, about what to do, what not to do, about morality, about emotions, about how to handle childhood traumas, whether to cry or not to cry, whether to do or not to do, how to behave, how to, you know, how to perceive themselves. is the interpretation of this wound. You are struggling with this wound in your intimate dark moment. Then you dress them up while you grow up and you try the power, already power privileges that have behind you, to push past them, to avoid them. And in the end, when you finally become the, when you finally choose to give up or not to give up, whatever you choose to decide, one part of you dies and one part of you, the self-image versus the image. We're living in a society that sacrifices itself for self-image. That's the third painting. That's what patriarchy does to you. That in the end, you're always half. Patriarchy is wounding men too. You are not complete to be yourself. You are killing something inside of you to even attain that power. It has that scar. That scar is very visible. It's going to stay. Making sense? Not making sense?
Shall I close this window?
Yeah. So, questions. This is one of the most powerful paintings that you can use to understand the idea of self, the idea of self in modernity, the idea of self emotionally, the idea of self in sexuality, the idea of self in, you know, discovering one's place in a political social environment, in a gendered body. So I think it has been made, something made sense, I hope. I was not all nonsense. So yeah, if any questions, then we're here.
Any questions? It has been a 2-hour lecture.
I told you I'll take half an hour more, and still I left a lot of things behind.
Yeah, so, but it was interesting. Like, it was,
I did not bore you with paintings and art.
No, as far as I'm concerned, I was not bored. I don't know about the students. They'll speak for themselves.
Hey, please speak for yourself, sir. I'm very nervous.
I think it was a different perspective towards art, like not one that I had seen before or not one that I had explored before. And it was quite a good presentation. And I really liked the way you presented and the different perspectives that you provided.
Okay. Thank you. I hope we can do this more elaborately someday. Any questions, please? Anything, any comments, feedbacks, anything
Bhakti you would like to explore? Bhakti is silent today. Bhakti.
Did it help you with anything? I mean, was this in your journey of whatever, however you have planned your education to be your pursuit of knowledge? Did it help? Did it help provide any perspective, anything new?
Ma'am, till now, we have always been accustomed with knowing that how homosexuality have always been prevalent in India, but we don't know the actual factual basis of it, or don't have the factual content or to back it up. But after the lecture, we do have the factual evidence needed to provide the basis which is needed to state that homosexuality and all kinds of sexuality has been prevalent in India since a long time.
Yeah, I told you this is going to help you with a lot of case studies. So you can use this in a lot of theories as an example, a lot of these paintings, yeah, especially Mughal art.
Definitely.
So we have another guest lecture coming up next week on masculinity.
Wow, okay. So, I would like to attend.
I'll be sharing you a link. I have already talked to the resource person. He'll be joining us. So it's going to be nice. I thought that since this is something virtual, why not try something which is otherwise not possible. So on Monday and Tuesday, I'll be taking lectures myself. And I think on Wednesday, we'll again have a guest lecture on masculinity. And with that, maybe we'll also finish credit second. But thank you, Soumya, for joining us. It was really nice, you know, because philosophy is methodological, but art has a very different reality to it. When you try to understand concepts through art, it's completely different. I guess when we have a lecture on sexuality, students are going to connect, and they're it's going to become easier for them to understand, because when it's all about, becomes a bit dry as well. So this time it has not been like that, and I think somewhere it will help them understand a lot of concepts that are otherwise very difficult and complicated to understand. Yeah, Ira wants to say something. Ira, go ahead. Can you hear me?
I can't hear anyone. Like, I can hear you or not if somebody else is speaking.
I don't know. Yeah, Ira wanted to say something, but...
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you are. Go ahead. So,
ma'am, thank you so much for, your presentation today. I am myself not very familiar with the way that you can interpret art and you can see it. But the way you actually, even though briefly, taught us how to look at that art was really enlightening. And this is going to be with me. And I also wanted to thank you for bringing out something the sculptures in Khajuraho. They are actually cited everywhere, like you said, that when it's of convenience, they will be parts of the conversation. But what underlies that depiction is something that we are not aware of, because primarily no one ever brings it up like that. So thank you so much for covering that for us.
I'm glad. I am actually highly interested in exploring tantric traditions, yogini cult, and I've as part of a lot of my courses, I went on fieldwork, hunted down. In fact, I'll send you some things that you'll be shocked to see. You'll never have seen something like this, the cultures that come out of tantric traditions. And these are something that challenge everything that they're telling, the Hindutva ideology is telling you that Hinduism is. Okay? There's nothing called Hinduism. This word is a farce in itself. There are different cults, there are different philosophies, there are different theologies, but all of them are in such opposition to each other that, the truly constitution is the only thing that we stand to be united for, okay? Some humanistic principles. There's nothing common between any two ritual practices in India. They're complete different ideologies. They cannot coexist. And that is their greatest fault, that they're constantly designing the enemy outside. The enemy is Pakistan. The enemy is this community, this Muslim, this gender, this anti-national, this university, blah, blah, blah. But they're not looking at the contradictions within themselves. They're not looking at the contradictions of caste and gender hierarchies, of sexuality, of multiple traditions of understanding love and body and emotions within this context. And that will explode on their faces. Tomorrow, if it does become a Hindu Rashtra,